Hello, this is Politicus Magnus. I'm sorry that it's been a while. I've been a little busy, and I've been working on this new video titled International Communists Attempt to Erase Votes. And this is about Brexit and Trump's 2016 election and subsequent, I think at this point we can call them coup attempts. So the comparison that I'm making is essentially somewhat twofold. So the first part of that is undoing the votes. And so with Brexit, we see they want to essentially undo the vote. And with Trump, ever since he got elected, we've seen them scurrying like crazy to try to, again, undo a vote in a different way, of course. And then the second thing is that we see new institutions or attempts to eliminate old institutions. So in the United States, we see this attack on the Electoral College, specifically for the presidency, is the only thing it's for in the United States. And it was set up originally to prevent war, essentially, between the cities, rural versus city. And that was set up in the beginning for that very reason, and it persists to this day. Of course, American cities generally have about 2 to 3 days worth of food on supermarket shelves for, you know, everybody that lives there. And so it's always trucked in. It's called on-demand delivery. And so the cities don't actually have food in them enough to support a population generally for more than a little while. 3 days or so in the supermarket shelves, and then whatever people have stockpiled if they listen. And then the second thing is the UK Supreme Court, which was created just a few years ago by the Labour Party, I believe. And in this case, we have a new institution that was just created. Of course, Britain doesn't have a formal constitution, as the United States does, but it does work on precedent. And this new institution in the UK Supreme Court also basically is looking to create a coup in the government by overriding both the Prime Minister and the Queen in terms of proroguing Parliament so that Britain is assured to actually leave the European Union on the postponed date of, I think, the end of Halloween, the end of October, so this month. And the Supreme Court, unlike the high courts of the rest of Britain for the most part, struck down the proroguing, which there's absolutely zero precedent for, and there's other aspects to that. But these two, particularly the Electoral College and the UK Supreme Court, one eliminating something old and one creating something new, thus changing the rules. And we'll see a lot about changing the rules as we get into both of these things and how the rules continue to change whenever you defy what we should just openly call what they are, global communists. So something that a millennial friend of mine actually reminded me of, I don't really consider myself a millennial, I'm middle 30s. So my friend who's a bit younger reminded me that millennials basically don't understand the Cold War. And I think the reason is twofold. First of all, the school system has done a pretty bad job of educating students for the past more than 20 years about the Cold War. I was pretty young when the wall came down, but I do remember it. And I do have some, I was telling my friend, I do still have some of that. I know what it's like to have that feeling that, you know, the world could come to an end at any time. I was explaining that after the Cold War, after the wall came down and the Soviet Union fell, there was a sense of relief. And everybody, I think, just wanted to forget about it because the whole thing, I mean, 60 years of Cold War was pretty traumatic. But between 1947 and 1991, there was a lot of things happening, and the Cold War was a real war, and there was a lot of actions being taken, of course, most of which were proxy wars, if larger, and then just spy versus spy type stuff otherwise. And it was mostly spy versus spy type stuff and influence and propaganda and all of that, like Yuri Bezmenov talks about with regard to his role in India before he defected. And there's another guy who's very important, a defector, Anatoly Golitsyn. While Bezmenov had a lot of insights, especially from the ground level of the types of agents that the KGB would use to infiltrate countries and set them up in certain ways, get the right people talking about the right things, and just generally trying to create influence as the primary goal, but also running agents and spies and things. Golitsyn was higher up. Golitsyn was part of the strategic planning department in the KGB, and he had a rank of major. I do strongly recommend watching various videos and reading various things by Yuri Bezmenov. He's got a lot to say about how the KGB ran things on the ground in terms of the strategic operations and so forth, Directorate K, things like that, just how it was done on the ground. But that's a bit below the sort of meta-analysis type level, strategic level things we'll be talking about in this episode here. And in that case, we're primarily talking about what's sometimes colloquially called the Golitsyn plan. And this is regarding Anatoly Golitsyn. Anatoly Golitsyn defected on December 15, 1961 to the Helsinki branch of the CIA. He was debriefed by James Jesus Angleton, or J.J. Angleton, who was the head of CIA counterintelligence for a long time. I think he was director for 20 years. Golitsyn gave him a lot of information, which led to the discovery of various spies and so forth, including the Cambridge Five. So his intelligence was very good, and he got a reputation for very good intelligence, but also as a conspiracy theorist, quote-unquote. Of course, this was the guy in charge, in some respect, in the strategic planning group of the KGB of making the strategic plans, which would be the conspiracies themselves. So the idea that this stuff was all very conspiratorial is dead on, because it literally was the KGB's conspiracy planning department. And what they planned is pretty similar to what Bezmenov describes from the ground level, which is infiltration, subversion, and a staged step-by-step system. Which Bezmenov talks about as in four stages: demoralization, destabilization, crisis, and normalization. And these each have meanings. Demoralization is bringing the morale of the country down to the point where it can be destabilized, which is to say to get some fighting in the streets, as it were, to get the cultural and political system in the country to start breaking down so that words, let's say, lose their meaning and things can't really be discussed. Crisis is where you can bring that to a civil war, a revolution, or some other bloody conflict. And normalization, of course, is when the communists come in at the end and, as Bezmenov says, kill all the useful idiots and take over, and then normalize that to the population psychologically. Bezmenov, in particular, he was quoted as saying, "Only about 15% of the time money and manpower is spent on espionage as such. The other 85% is a slow process which we call either ideological subversion or active measures." We've heard those words quite a bit recently, haven't we? Active measures. Or active measures or psychological warfare. And playing the chess game on the grand chessboard was Anatoly Golitsyn, of course, who defected something like 8 years prior to Bezmenov, who was planning all of that stuff, and probably was planning, even potentially at the time, some of the things that Bezmenov would be doing a little later, a few years later. So Golitsyn is at the very top of this triangle, let's say, if we just stick with three of the main groups involved in KGB subversion operations, external psychological warfare operations. So you've got Golitsyn at the top, and that ends in 1961, however, so it's early on, at the top at the Strategic Planning Department. And then between where Bezmenov was on the ground level as an actual field agent doing psychological operations, recruiting, and so forth, was a notorious organization called Directorate K. And what that was, and we've got information from some other people later on, we didn't have this information back then, I think, but we got information later on, I think, maybe even after the wall came down, about Directorate K and much more about it when things became declassified. And what they were is they basically were the security division at the embassies, but also with foreign field operations, which, again, were primarily soft power-mediated, political influence-based, propagandistic subversion in order to create chaos, and in order then to use that to leverage either civil war or revolution or some other actual crisis. And that's the four stages that we see in Bezmenov's description, which are known to be accurate. So beyond the fact that Anatoly Golitsyn, after defecting, outed the Cambridge Five by pointing at several of them within the Cambridge Five, and then the rest were discovered in the top positions in British governments. Watch the movie Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy. which is about that. Actually, J.J. Angleton debriefing Anatoly Golitsyn is what actually brought down the Cambridge Five. And so this was a big head honcho, essentially, in the strategic planning department who had defected and was giving the Soviets entire, essentially, 50-100-year plan to the West, specifically via the CIA counterintelligence. J.J. Angleton, famously in this case, pretty much ran the entire case and was the debriefer for virtually all of it, to my knowledge. And that's very important. So not only the Cambridge Five, but then just to get an idea of how high up Golitsyn was and what a risk and threat that he actually was, just looking at the Wikipedia and going through this, there's a few other things, I think. But in January 1962, the KGB sent instructions to 54 Rezidentura throughout the world on actions required to minimize the damage from Golitsyn's defection. November 1962, KGB had approved a plan for assassination of Golitsyn and other particularly dangerous traitors, quote-unquote, and the KGB made significant efforts to discredit Golitsyn and promote disinformation that he was involved in illegal smuggling operations. Such were the lengths that the KGB and the top Soviet high command were willing to go in order to discredit and potentially try to assassinate Anatoly Golitsyn. So later on in the 80s and the 90s, Golitsyn wrote two books, the first called New Lies for Old, and the second called The Perestroika Deception. And in these two books, he details his, I guess, personal view on the overall Soviet plan for propaganda and strategic operations with the KGB, based on what he knew from what he saw, and also potentially information that he may have gotten in exchange with J.J. Angleton. And in these books, he makes various predictions, dozens, in fact, and many estimates have them at least over 90% coming true over the years since he made the predictions. Some of them hadn't come true, but there were wrinkles in the plan, as it were, things that happened historically that weren't anticipated, of course, back before 1961. But this is a long-term Soviet plan, and he was watching as he saw it play out in front of him, and then based on what he knew from his debriefing and also working in strategic planning division, he predicted the fall of the Berlin Wall, he predicted that the Soviet Union would fall, but he predicted that that was a ruse. And that seems to have actually been the case, that the Russians were still essentially following the Golitsyn plan, or what we would call it, their old, you know, Soviet KGB plan. But then Putin won in 2000 in Russia, and that pretty much squashed the communist groups in Russia that were behind the scenes in the Russian mafia and the oligarchy, and were still running essentially as the KGB running Russia after the fall of the Soviet Union, which is, if you ask around, that's generally, I think, how it was. So the old KGB plan assumed that they would have Russia, the communists, that is, for their global takeover. But then, because of the election of Vladimir Putin in 2000, that pretty much went up in smoke. But the plan was still going on globally via what essentially would amount to the Communist International, the International Communists, which, of course, since the Soviet Union generally was strongly, strongly tied to the Soviets primarily, more so, of course, than the Chinese, of course, in the West, at least, and generally speaking. The Chinese have only recently gotten into Africa and so forth. So that is to say, then, that this KGB plan, this Golitsyn plan that we learned about from Anatoly Golitsyn, has continued in the West since 2000, assuming that Russia is not on board. Of course, from people that we now see are tied in with this apparent re-emergent communist conspiracy, which does in fact go back to the original KGB plan / Golitsyn plan, some people would want to start a war with Russia, for example, via Syria, for example, by destabilizing the Middle East and causing the Arab Spring in the first place, and then arming ISIS rebels, and then, of course, knowing that, at least in Syria, the Russians would intervene, which they have, and an air war in Syria with the Russians, or if we were to take out the Syrian anti-missile systems, of course, would start a war, potentially, because all of the Syrian missile systems using Russian equipment are manned by Russian troops, so you can't not kill Russians bombing those. And which CIA hand-chosen presidential candidate was dead set on war in Syria and a very likely war with Russia, Hillary Clinton, with the backing of the entire Democrat National Committee. Now, it might have sounded a bit crazy, maybe it still sounds crazy to say that it appears that the Democratic National Committee, the Democrat Party in the United States, and I will also point out the Labour Party, etc., in the UK, and some Tories who have now been expelled, traitors, are all part of this communist group, and they have been for a long time, from Saul Alinsky and on. And now what was a conspiracy theory, albeit one from the top-level Soviet defector that ever defected to the CIA, debriefed by one of the most famous, for being the best, counterintelligence director in U.S. history, it all seems to have been true. And for some reason, now is the time that this plan is being activated in the West. So that was a very long introduction. Sorry to say that was the introduction. And sort of will generally serve as the conclusion. Of course, we'll come back to the specifics of the argument. And so now I want to get into the actual argument. That was sort of the preface, information that's necessary, I think, to understand, which again my friend suggested, and he's certainly probably right, that millennials don't really remember the Cold War. So that's a good flashback and a good reminder of the Golitsyn plan and things like that, the sort of planning that the KGB did and the sorts of methods that they used in order to subvert countries very successfully, actually, in many countries, with those four pillars of demoralization, then destabilization, where we still are, and entering into the crisis mode, crisis normalization. So to start off with the discussion comparing Brexit and the election of Trump to the presidency of the U.S., I'll again point out that I'm taking it directly that the Democrats in the United States and the Labor and the Liberal Democrats, etc., and very clearly the heads of the European Union as well, are in league in this Golitsyn plan, in this communist old KGB conspiracy that they've carried on and changed as the times have changed and the plans had to be adapted. But now we're starting to see the plan directly, and these people are coming out and saying, yes, we are coming for your guns. Yes, we want to eliminate in the United States the Electoral College. In the UK, they want to retain this ridiculous UK Supreme Court, which was created by a Labour government and only a few years ago, and now in its first and only major decision has overturned the Queen and the Prime Minister and the government without precedent and with a very, very flimsy argument, voting unanimously to essentially to remain in the European Union and negate the vote. And that's the whole thing that we're seeing this group, this one group, I'm saying is one group, including the DNC and Labour and Lib Dem and so forth, and the EU. That's their whole game now, to negate the vote, whether it's for Donald Trump or whether it's for the Brexit. So to give an example from Brexit, the Liberal Democrats had Guy Verhofstadt at their party conference, and he gave a little speech. I won't read the whole thing. It's not very long. You can go watch it. But this is a quote from the beginning of the speech. He says, "The world order of tomorrow is not a world order based on nation states, on countries. It's a world order that is based on empires." And he gives ridiculous examples like China, India, and the U.S. as empires, which the EU empire is supposed to rival, is what's clearly implied. But the U.S., China, and India are not empires. I mean, they could be considered as such at one time, but they're nations. The exact opposite of what this guy is saying. And so his examples, his own examples, make no sense. But it's very clear what he wants. And he's following the same no borders, no nations, communist international rhetoric as has been around since, well, since the communist international has existed and wrote their songs and slogans. The goal of communism, of course, is global communism. And so there can't be any borders or nations. There must be one global communist state, which is the end goal of communism. So that's the guy negotiating with Britain for a deal when they leave the EU, if they don't leave without a deal, which at this point I think would be preferred immediately. But that's that guy. And so you can see what the negotiators for the UK are up against. And so that was Guy Verhofstadt at the Liberal Democrats conference giving that speech. They invited him there. This is a British political party. They also wrote a letter to the European Union expressing their desire to remain in the EU and hoping that they can use dirty, underhanded political tactics essentially to either gain power or somehow stop Brexit completely, and also try to have a second referendum in order to overturn the original vote. Because as we've seen with the EU many times, if countries vote against the EU, they need to keep voting until they vote for it. And then once they vote for it, no more voting. It's a Soviet-style system. It's happened again and again. And of course, the European Parliament doesn't even make the laws. That's made by unelected, appointed officials in the European Commission. Absolute Soviet-style system. And now we see the very person in charge of negotiating Brexit with the British government is a diehard globalist international communist who wants to see the end of borders and nations and apparently the rise of quote-unquote empires, for which he actually does not provide any examples, because the nations that he lists are nation states, and the United States in particular, with an absolute constitution above all other laws, not an empire. But also, of course, nothing like the draconian and Soviet-style European Union, which he wants to be an empire, and also wants to have its own army. What do you know? And clearly the Democrats in the U.S. are on the same page as the rest of the global left, the global communists. So that's an example of obvious communists who want to undo the vote in Britain, and who are all for the Soviet-style European Union, ensuring that once you get in, you can never get out, and even the United Kingdom can never leave. This same sabotage is echoed in everything else that's pretty much been done with regard to Brexit. Theresa May came into power as Prime Minister to negotiate Brexit in July of 2016, and it's very clear that she botched the deal intentionally. It's also very clear that the negotiators on the EU side were very much intending to essentially enslave Britain and get a quote-unquote deal in which Britain would leave in name only and simply, for the most part, just lose its MEPs, which don't make the laws anyway, so not much of a difference actually, but in principle, no longer a sovereign nation. And no longer even rhetorically voting for the laws that it's held to, and which its own courts must enforce. The so-called Brexit deal with Theresa May was voted on several times and was struck down by the Parliament every single time by a vast majority because it was so horrible. It's very clear that May did not attempt to put any pressure on the EU negotiators, and essentially laid back and got the worst deal possible to bring to the Parliament. This type of sabotage is very clear on both sides. Again, we're going to talk about Brexit versus the multiple coup attempts now against Donald Trump after he won the presidency, and which essentially started before he even won the presidency, while he was still even just starting up his campaign. So then with Brexit, of course, there is more sabotage, with the EU being very willing participants. Because May's non-deal was rejected by the Parliament, the time was extended on March 21st, 2019, to Halloween, October 31st, 2019, which is coming up. After that, May was deposed as the Prime Minister of the Tories and replaced with Boris Johnson. And that was on July 24th. And then in another act of sabotage, there was a vote held in order to stop any no-deal Brexit, which is to say, the Parliament voting to make it illegal to leave the EU without a deal, which the Remainers had already sabotaged. And that vote was on September 3rd, in which case 21 Tories, who were traitors to their party and on the Remainer side, voted for the bill, which was later put into law by the Queen on September 9th. On September 4th, those 21 Tory traitors were purged from the party and simply kicked out, leaving the Tory government in the minority. Boris Johnson had gotten permission from the Queen to prorogue Parliament on August 28th, and to prorogue it between the 9th and 12th of September and October 14th, which is just before the October 31st Halloween Brexit deadline, the new deadline. However, the vote to make a no-deal Brexit illegal was on September 3rd, again, and then, of course, on the 4th, those 21 Tory traitors had to be expelled from the party, and the party became a minority government under Boris Johnson. And then the Remainers decided to file a bunch of court cases, which made it all the way up to the high courts, which struck them down, essentially, for the most part, saying that Boris Johnson and the Queen were perfectly right to prorogue Parliament, as it had not been prorogued for a long time, and therefore the proroguing was a little longer this time. But then it went to the UK Supreme Court, which again is a new institution that was set up by a Labour government just in mid-2000s under Tony Blair. And this is its first really important ruling, and it ruled against all the other courts, and it ruled that the Queen's signature was null and void, if not illegal, and that even asking the Queen to prorogue Parliament by the Prime Minister was somehow an illegal act, which had no legal effect. So that was just a basic rundown, and not particularly in order, but anybody who's been following this stuff has an idea, at least, of what's been going on so many times that they've tried to negate the vote and somehow stay in the European Union, because the European project is their global communist project. And so I want to compare the Brexit and all of that and its potential outcomes in the end. We can talk about that with Trump in the U.S. and the attempts continually to essentially have a coup. We had the Democrats working all over the place to try to find anything on Trump and anyone around him. We had the two-year Mueller investigation, which concluded with no indictments and no illegal activities on the part of the Trump campaign at all. The conclusion that Russian GRU agents were significantly influencing the election with $1.2 million in Facebook ads or something like that, versus however many tens of billions were spent in that 2016 presidential campaign, also is patently ridiculous, in the sense that it could have affected anything, and everybody admits that it had no real effect. There's also the fact that the Russian meddling, as it were, this small group of Facebook ad posters and social media trolls, essentially, were 50-50 split between Hillary Clinton and Trump in terms of positive and negative memes and statements. And so the conclusion by the intelligence agencies and everyone else was essentially that they were simply trying to increase division in the U.S. And that goes along the lines of what they do every election, everywhere. And we do similar things when it suits us, of course. The CIA is not completely innocent of things like this, obviously. So much for the whole Russia thing, and I'm definitely not going to get into that, because that clearly turned out to be completely ridiculous and a hit job and a coup attempt by the previous administration and its intelligence organizations using fake FISA fraudulent court proceedings, where they lied to the FISA court to get fraudulent FISA ability to spy on the Trump campaign. They used foreign agents, former MI5, MI6 agents, Ukrainian agents, and also contact with Russian agents, which they took at their word for some reason. And so, of course, as it turns out, the Democrats probably did more to spread Russian propaganda in that election than even maybe the Russians themselves. But then, of course, now we're not hearing anything about Russia anymore, are we? Now it's about Ukraine, which is at war with Russia. So somehow it went from Putin to what amounts to his arch enemy at the current point in time with regard to who Russia's at war with, Zelensky. And that makes no sense, which is why we're not hearing a damn thing about Russia anymore. So now we have a new coup attempt. And now they're trying to accuse Trump of trying to put pressure on Zelensky using a $1 billion loan or whatever as leverage, and this is for military support, to use that as leverage in order to get him to investigate Joe Biden. But there's a lot more to that story behind the scenes, and this thing with Biden is only a tiny little part in a much larger, essentially a conspiracy to steal money from the U.S. government through the newly founded Ukrainian government after Obama and his administration took down the previous Ukrainian administration, that was a Russian puppet, Yanukovych, who was deposed in February of 2014 in what was a CIA color revolution. After this color revolution in the Ukraine, the U.S. handpicked and installed Yatsenyuk as the prime minister and Poroshenko as the president. The leaked conversation between Victoria Nuland, the Assistant Secretary of State for European and Eurasian Affairs at the time, and the U.S. Ambassador to Ukraine at the time, Geoffrey Pyatt, I think that's how you pronounce it, was leaked in February of 2014, the call being prior to that, of course, and it's unknown exactly when it happened, but before February 7th, 2014, and they're discussing who they're going to install in the government and conclude that Yatsenyuk will be the prime minister. How they settled on Poroshenko later is another story, but they installed these people after overthrowing the government in a color revolution. And given the information available now, it would seem that Yatsenyuk and Poroshenko played a huge role in the corrupt nature of the Obama administration setting up a new government in a country which they had recently toppled the government of with the CIA. For example, we later learned in the Panama Papers that Poroshenko was doing some illegal things to hide the fact that he didn't sell his business as promised when he ran for the presidency in the first place. That corruption may be just one of the public scandals that caused Zelensky to recently win this year the presidency with over 73% of the vote. Finally bringing the DNC puppet presidency of Poroshenko to an end, which is why Trump was interested in speaking with him, one about opening previous investigations, which, by the way, precede the Trump administration altogether, and which were closed under nefarious circumstances, from the evidence anyways, that we have available now. Biden threatening the Ukraine with a $1 billion grant loan guarantee was just the tip of the iceberg, and just a tiny little thing in the whole picture. And what isn't tiny, and does regard Biden, actually, because he was running a lot of this later on. When I say later on, I mean after the revolution, with the State Department, particularly with Victoria Nuland as well as a spearhead on that on the ground, and obviously the ambassador that we heard on the phone call with Nuland. And so this is how we get to either $2.97 billion or the equivalent, apparently, I'm not sure how that's calculated, of $4.51 billion U.S. dollars was guaranteed in IMF loans, which is to say IMF special drawing rights in the form of $2.97 billion. And again, the equivalency, I think, is because it's creating money. It's something to do with banking. I'm not sure about that equivalency. But at least $3 billion or so dollars were guaranteed to Ukraine through, for some reason, Privat Bank. Now, Privat Bank has no public shareholders whatsoever. And so it's completely privately owned. By whom? I don't think we know. I don't know. Anyways, in the research that I did, I didn't find it. And apparently, this Privat Bank is associated directly with Burisma and Ihor Kolomoisky, and that is associated to the whole Biden thing. But again, that is just a piece of it, a tiny tip of the iceberg piece of it, the Biden thing. But it leads into all of this. Privat Bank lost these billions of dollars. Lost it. Don't know where it went. Where did it go? So that's the real scandal here, because that was backed by the U.S. government, which means that's at least $3 billion or so in U.S. taxpayer dollars. And that's on top of the $5 billion or so that Victoria Nuland openly admitted on camera at some conference that her department at the State Department spent to overthrow the Ukrainian government, which was, of course, a Russian puppet government working with Russia to dominate the gas market, etc. There were legitimate reasons for the U.S. to want to do that. Of course, it destabilized the region and also led to the whole seizure of Crimea by the Russians, who will never let those military bases go without a nuclear war because they consider them to be necessary for national security, and they are, as one of them is the only year-round warm water port that's a major port for the Russian Navy. And that started the whole war in Donetsk and Lugansk in the east of Ukraine with the Russians. Technically Russian proxies because they don't claim to be Russian, nor do they wear Russian uniforms. But many of them are Russian soldiers who are, quote-unquote, volunteering. So anyways, when Trump made the call to the new president of Ukraine, Zelensky, in July, there was a military aid package which was for some apparently other reason delayed. Not postponed, just delayed, and so it was going through no matter what. I'm not sure what the delay was, but apparently it's unrelated. And so these investigations had been closed, and that's what I'm going to get into next. These investigations into missing billions of dollars in U.S. taxpayer money and how they were closed and why Trump would want them reopened. Again, these investigations had been going on before the Trump administration. Now, I don't want to get too far into all the Ukrainian stuff because there's others that have done a lot of work on that, and it would be even longer of a video, and it's already getting very long. So to get to the main points, that's the general backdrop upon which the call that Trump made with Zelensky occurred and essentially what they were actually talking about. And now we can get into some of the cover-ups that have already taken place previously with regard to these investigations, why they were closed. These cases were closed by direct pressure through the government of both the United States, through Joe Biden and the State Department in general, and the people that they had installed on the ground in Ukraine, all the way up to Yatsenyuk and Poroshenko. So let's talk about the so-called whistleblower, but I'm not going to call him that, because that's not what he is. So it's not clear whether or not this person first went to Adam Schiff and the House Intelligence Committee, specifically only the Democrats on that committee in the House, whether he went there first or whether he actually filed any kind of complaint first. The hotline for the ICIG, or Intelligence Community Inspector General, does have a method of contacting Congress directly, the intelligence committees, that is, before filing an urgent concern disclosure form, which this person also did. And there are some issues with that. It turns out that the House Intelligence Committee was contacted by this person, possibly before the disclosure form was made. After Adam Schiff said that they had never met with this person, it later came out that they had spoken with him, but then later a spokesperson for the Intelligence Committee came out and said that this person hadn't given any testimony to the committee. Whether or not Schiff spoke with this person before the filing of the urgent concern disclosure form with the ICIG, or even potentially helping write it, as Trump suggests, which, other than Trump saying that, we have no evidence of that, but we do have evidence, of course, that Schiff seems to have lied about meeting this person, and that's not the only lie involved here. So now let's talk about the urgent concern disclosure form that was filed. The filing was with the so-called old form, which is before the form was actually changed, which was quite recently. And on this urgent concern disclosure form, this person, who has been revealed to be a CIA analyst, an officer in the Central Intelligence Agency, who was stationed at the White House, this person checked two boxes that are both felony offenses for each box. The first box that was checked incorrectly on the form was the box about direct knowledge, saying that this person had direct knowledge and witnessed whatever event they were describing. And then also there was a box for previous disclosures, asking whether or not this person had reported it to other groups, such as the intelligence committees in the House and Senate. This person checked the box saying that they had not previously disclosed this information to anyone else, which would include the intelligence committees. We now know that was not true. Lying on the form is an act of perjury, and at the bottom of the form, it says that each count under statute carries 5 years in federal prison and or a $10,000 fine, and that is a federal felony for each count. And so now we're in the position where the CIA and the FBI are protecting this so-called quote-unquote whistleblower, who is actually guilty of at least two federal felonies, which are related to completely lying on the form. He's a registered Democrat and met with only the Democrats on the House Intelligence Committee. This is directly for an impeachment-type investigation. Of course, given the facts about Ukraine, and now given the facts about this leaker slash political operative within the CIA, we should just come out and call him what he is, which is a deep state agent, a holdover, sleeper, among the other sleeper cells installed under the Obama administration. So based on all of the evidence, this person is a partisan, took advantage of their position being stationed at the White House for the CIA, may have simply fabricated out of whole cloth what they say they were told, which is pure hearsay in the most literal and legal sense. They approached the Democrats only on the House Intelligence Committee, specifically led by Adam Schiff, who lied about being approached. He lied on the forms, and somehow magically the forms were changed so that an urgent concern disclosure form could be filed without having direct knowledge, whereas previously direct knowledge was required. And that is the main reason that the White House had originally basically thrown that complaint out and filed it away wherever rejected complaints are filed, because the policy was that you had to be a first-hand witness to something. You could not bring hearsay to the ICIG, and you could not use hearsay to file that form. The form would be rejected based on hearsay and not having direct knowledge or witness of the events described. Of course, we also know that the person lied on the form, so that must have also been known to determine that that person had lied. Clearly, no charges were filed, even though there were two felonies committed in the filing of the form in the first place, by lying, by checking those boxes, which were blatant lies, obviously politically calculated. But the Trump administration didn't try to prosecute. They just said, this is BS because it's hearsay, and we don't accept that. But somehow, the form got changed by the ICIG at the same time. And suddenly, this person with only hearsay and no direct knowledge is so-called a whistleblower because the form was changed. If that doesn't scream deep state coup attempt, what does? Now, one might say whether or not it's a deep state coup attempt against the president, maybe they're onto something. What did the president say? Well, they released the transcripts, or at least what they have of them, from typists. I guess since Nixon, they stopped recording phone calls. You could probably understand why. They're not legally obligated to do so, only to keep a record, and so it's a stenographer. So Schiff and the Democrats that are for this impeachment inquiry, quote-unquote, which is not even official by any stretch of the imagination because the House has not voted on it at all, and this is another instance where the Democrats, in this case, don't want to have a vote, much like Labour and the Liberal Democrats in Britain don't want to have a general election. They don't want to vote on whether or not to have an impeachment hearing or inquiry. They're just going to declare it, even though it's not official, and they're lying to the American people about the process in the House of Representatives. So they're focused on Trump saying, could you do me a favor, though? And for some reason, the word though is really important, because somehow that automatically implies that Zelensky and Ukraine will not get the military aid package, which again was simply delayed, apparently for other reasons, and which Zelensky knows that he will get, regardless, because it's already been decided and allocated. Somehow the word though, after could you do me a favor, is what makes Trump guilty here, of doing what Biden actually did on camera in front of everyone, and then bragged about several times, also on camera, in front of everyone, including the press. So, given that the aid package was never on the line in the first place, that magical word though has no meaning whatsoever, because there was no opportunity even for tit for tat, because the aid package was simply delayed and was inevitable, and that was known to all the parties. Trump also had a bunch of people on the phone with him, as did Zelensky, which is normal for such conversations. Everybody's listening. There's nothing private about it, and so it's not any kind of solicitation whatsoever. There's zero evidence for that. So then the final possible aspect that the Democrats could and probably will then cling to is, why is Trump talking about this in the first place? There is no evidence for any tit-for-tat or asking based on money, based on the aid package, for anything. But why was Trump bringing it up? Well, first of all, Trump didn't bring it up. Zelensky did. And second of all, from what we know from the previous discussion of what was actually going on in Ukraine under Obama and everything else that could be implied from that, there were previous investigations, all prior to Trump even getting elected or taking office. And the previous investigations being shut down happened under Poroshenko, who the Obama administration had installed as a DNC puppet regime. Now that Zelensky was in office and Poroshenko was out, Trump could get those investigations started again. And considering that it was billions of U.S. dollars in taxpayer-funded money lost to these corruption scandals, it's definitely in the purview of the top law enforcement official of the United States, who appoints the Attorney General, who appoints the Secretary of State, and who literally has the power to deputize anyone to be a U.S. Marshal, which is why Giuliani acting as an agent of the president is actually completely fine. In fact, the president could make it completely official and simply deputize him as a U.S. Marshal. And so Trump wanting these investigations reopened is a valid law enforcement concern for the United States and the president, especially if you know how they were closed in the first place. And this shows just how corrupt the Obama administration was, with the CIA and the State Department setting up their own little puppet regime in Ukraine to replace that of Putin's puppet regime. So, for example, just with Biden's thing, we have Mykola Zlochevsky as the owner of Brokiti Investments Limited, who is the former Minister of Natural Resources under Viktor Yanukovych, and the owner of Burisma, which is again linked into this whole thing. And so, of course, we have the obstruction of justice in Ukraine by Joe Biden when he was the vice president and when he was spearheading the State Department's and the executive's general setting up of the Ukrainian puppet regime after the Color Revolution there. And, of course, the world may never know just how he got the money to finance that company in the first place to use all of his political connections that he got from being a minister under Yanukovych, who was the Russian puppet. Between him and Kolomoisky, you almost have a corrupt billionaire James Bond villain party getting started. I'm not even going to bring up Open Society Foundations working with USAID and the CIA and all of that in the Color Revolution and beyond. And in Brexit, you can go ahead and look into it yourself. There's also the fact that the prosecutor who was fired by Biden's word and threat to withhold that billion-dollar aid has come out and said that that is the reason that he was fired. And of course the new guy that they replaced him with isn't going to investigate. The last guy got fired for doing so, and he knew that. So now nobody will investigate until Zelensky wins and replaces all the bad guys, all of their guys. And that's why Trump was talking about it, and why Zelensky's the one who brought it up. And there could even be more Trump-related things going on with regard to this whole thing with Poroshenko and Yatsenyuk under the Obama administration during the whole Russiagate conspiracy, where they apparently went to the government in Kiev and asked them to interfere in our elections for them and to dig up dirt on Trump. Again, all of the things that they're trying to accuse Trump of doing. And we have Serhiy Lysenko saying that Trump's candidacy caused, quote, Kiev's wider political leadership to do something they would never have attempted before, intervene, however indirectly, in a U.S. election. That's a quote from Lysenko. That was in Chuck Grassley's letter on July 20th, 2017, long before any of this stuff. So this has been going on for a long time, and the investigations were stalled until Zelensky won. And again, he won with 73% of the vote. When does that happen? And Poroshenko was Obama's guy, and Biden's guy, and the Democrats' guy. And the new guy won with 73% of the vote, because they were corrupt as hell. And they're trying to cover their own tracks now by accusing Trump, because he looked into it, because now they don't have a guy in charge there. They're not in control anymore. And I think they're freaking out. In the WikiLeaks release of the DNC emails, and Hillary's emails particularly, Hillary is quoted as saying in one of her emails that if Trump wins, quote, we're all gonna hang. It's starting to sound more and more like that's literally true. During the time that the Obama administration, the DNC, and the Clinton campaign were doing their Russiagate stuff in Ukraine, there was an investigation into the Anti-Corruption Action Center, based on the fact that they'd also misplaced some money. An American embassy official, George Kent, wrote a letter to the prosecutor's office in Ukraine in April of 2016, asking them not to prosecute specific groups that were friendly with the administration. And it was also well known that this was because of the election and their backing of Hillary Clinton as well as part of that conspiracy. Again, well known in the groups that were actually involved in it, both in the U.S. and Ukraine. Yuri Lutsenko was the new prosecutor who wouldn't prosecute the Biden thing, and he got in a few months and then was given a list by the ambassador, Pirat, who George Kent had written on behalf of anyhow, including the founder of the Anti-Corruption Action Center and several members of parliament and others. Why was the Obama administration giving lists to the new Ukrainian prosecutor after they had the last one fired for looking into all of this, including Biden's stuff, of who not to go after or even investigate, let alone prosecute? The corruption is piled to the ceiling. Why would Hillary say that in her email? Trump's quip, "You'd be in jail," starting to sound kind of weird now, thinking about all this. What did he know? He was friends with them. What did they tell him? So in Britain and the United States, we see consistently from this same group, and they are the same group, the international communists. They've come out with everything that they want to do. Take the guns, no borders, no nations. They want the European Union to be the basis of a super state, which they plan, apparently, in the future to combine into a single global communist state. Both here and in Britain, we see them trying to overturn a vote of the people. We see them working toward the same global communist system, and that they're global in nature, and that they work with globalized billionaires and banks and everything else that they can to commit their crimes, that they are part of a conspiracy, that they will pretty much do anything in their power, whether it's legal or not, in order to win for their ideal system. Again, Yuri Bezmenov's four phases of communist subversion and finally takeover of a nation, according to the KGB checklist, as it were, are demoralization, destabilization, crisis, and normalization. Both the United States and Britain are paralyzed and held hostage by the global communists right now. There has been, in both countries, an internal coup inside of the government by this unified global communist fifth column. The crisis is upon us now. Both nations are on the verge of civil war. This is the end of the destabilization phase. This is the crisis, and there doesn't seem to be any negotiation left to do. They won't negotiate. They're forcing constitutional crises as well as the likelihood in both nations of civil war. There's no faith between the people and these communist resurgents. Over and over again, their lies and propaganda have come crashing down. Their narratives no longer work. Their lies have fallen apart, from Russiagate to this new Ukrainian thing, trying to overthrow the vote of the people because they thought that they would still have the presidency, and everybody knew it, and they were wrong. I don't see any way to argue anymore that these people are acting in good faith in any way, as we've seen with the EU, with the Chinese communists, with Labour and the Lib Dems in Britain, and the DNC in the United States, the Obama administration, and the groups that put this new UK Supreme Court in place, which has now taken complete political control of the UK and now holds its government hostage. Or if it's the fake quotes of Adam Schiff, or the lies behind the scenes meeting with this fake whistleblower who provides only hearsay from so-called anonymous sources while remaining anonymous and after having lied several times. These constitutional crises, these attempts to overrule the votes of the people, are intended to cause civil war, potentially as one of the crises. Crisis is the only goal. Does not matter to the communists, and it did not matter to the KGB how that crisis came about. All that mattered was who took power afterward. This is their final execution of the Golitsyn plan, of the KGB grand chessboard long game. They've decided to pull the trigger on that for some reason. Whether that was planned or whether that was an adaptation may never be known. But the Cold War didn't end with the fall of the Berlin Wall or the collapse of the Soviet Union or our own renormalization process with them in the Eastern Bloc for them to become capitalistic and at least more democratic. And while those countries have become such and have prospered greatly because of it and know that, in particular Poland and Hungary and these places that know what communism actually is, while they have normalized and prospered because of capitalism and democracy, representative democracy, The agents of communism in the West united. They took over institutions. They gained power. And now we see them executing that power in the final phase. Crisis is the goal. And now we are entering the crisis stage. In the UK, there is an attempt to use the court to force an extension on Johnson if there is no deal by the 19th of October. The case was filed in Scotland's High Court, apparently on October 4th. And then the European Union has already come out and said that they're considering a bypass if Boris Johnson doesn't send an extension letter, a letter requesting the extension, that they will grant it anyways, which could be vetoed by Hungary, for example. That is, so even if the government doesn't ask for an extension from the EU, the EU is happy to grant it and continue to collect their money every month in the billions. And then there's talk of putting Boris Johnson in prison if he doesn't send the letter, as they made a law specifically saying that he would have to send the letter in order to checkmate him to not have the power that the Prime Minister generally has. Again, an example of changing the rules. And now they're going to throw the Prime Minister in jail? Well, they've already negated the signature of the Queen, so Boris Johnson is asking the Queen to prorogue Parliament again on the 8th of October, which will likely happen, for a Queen's speech on October the 14th, and we'll see what happens with that. If these people prevent Brexit from happening, and enough people in the country see that their democracy, their representation, and what little of a constitution that they have has essentially been destroyed already in this, there may be civil war in Britain. I don't think there's going to be a question about weaponry, even though guns are supposedly illegal there. There are plenty of them, and getting them would be fairly easy for a rebel force, if they're considered the rebels anyways. Another possibility in Britain would be that the Queen interferes and overrules the Remainers and causes Britain to leave, potentially on the 31st, and that's accepted. That is a possibility, especially given the UK Supreme Court ruling and the nature of that new institution. I think the least likely option is that the European Union will give some sort of good enough deal that can pass the Parliament, and then the question, of course, would be, in this unlikely scenario, whether the UK is mostly in or mostly out of the EU, the specifics of the deal. In the US, the situation is complicated. One aspect of that is the media. It's not dissimilar to Britain in that respect. The complication is that even though the Democrats are very unlikely to get an impeachment started, or at any rate voted on, or to be approved and get the president kicked out, the odds are probably near zero. But because of the press making that seem not true, making it seem that it is possible, which any statistical analysis and counting votes will tell you is not going to happen, the press is still able to keep some half of the American population on the side of this communist fifth column, which is no longer the Democrat Party of the United States, but has been completely now taken over by the Communist International. But they have also taken over most of the media as well. And given the recent scandal, so-called, which turned out to backfire in the face of the Democrats who were plotting behind the scenes within the House and within the House Intelligence Committee, headed by Schiff, we can see that it's going to be the deep state in concert with these people that has any chance of causing a real coup against the president. This attempt with the Ukraine conversation with Zelensky reveals the underlying plan, which is not about impeachment by the House or conviction in the Senate, but which is actually about using sleeper cells within the deep state, which is only to say the intelligence community and the FBI, for example, and the DNI, for example, those people there who don't leave between administrations but are there essentially for life, but those that have been planted by previous administrations that were planting these people to be sleeper agents. And that seems to be the real goal currently of the global communists in the United States. now fraudulently using the Democrat Party as a dead mask to hide behind. That's one complicated electron.